Hello friends, I hope you all are good. Welcome to my YouTube channel. Today we are going to learn about literary canon, feminist canon and feminism in literature through this video with easier written notes. So I think we shall commence now. Firstly, we will discuss about literary canon. So what is canon? It is the word that is derived from the Greek word canon, which means a measuring rod. Literary canon. It refers to a body of text or works considered to be most important and influential in a particular time or place by which other writings are evaluated. Canon thus levels and straightens the literary taste by determining the value of the works produced in a literature with reference to the canonical works. It is a yardstick for measuring those works, their significance in the literary world. The word canon is first used with reference to Bible. A canonical book in Bible is the one that measures up to the standard of Holy Scripture and thus considered to be authentic and divine by the community. What is canon literature? It is accepted, authentic, valuable and representative. It signifies two things. Accepted and authoritative works of authors among the many attributed to them. And second, those authors accepted as representative of particular literature. Canon formation. The social process by which an author or a literary work comes to be tactfully recognized as canonical. Factors in this formative process are complex and disrupted. And disputed. A body of people, including writers and critics, scholars and academics, choose the canon and consider their works as classics. The boundary of canon is indefinite. The process involves some mutually interactive factors sustained over a period of time. Those factors are broad concurrence of critics and scholars and authors with diverse viewpoints and sensibilities, the persistent influence of and reference to an author in the work of other authors, the frequent reference to an author or work within the discourse of the cultural community, widespread assignment of the author or text in the school and college curricula. Criticism. Standard canon of great books, not only in literature but in all areas of humanistic study, has been determined less by artistic excellence than by the politics of power. It consists mainly of works that convey and sustain racism, patriarchy, and imperialism. It marginalizes and excludes the interests and accomplishments of blacks and Hispanics and other ethnic minorities, and also the achievement of women, the working class, popular culture, homosexuals and non-European civilizations. Defense. The canonical works have high intellectual and artistic quality. It has the power to give delight. They can appeal to widely shared human concerns and value, and are skeptical established way of thinking and support political radicalism. Many theorists who challenge the traditional English canon when they turn from theory to applied criticism attend preponderantly to established major authors like Shakespeare, Spencer, Jane Austen, Wordsworth. So recognize and confirm in practice the literary canon that they in theory oppose. Now we shall come to feminist canon. What are the issues and problems in the construction of feminist canon? Important works in feminist that bring revolution was the first text by Mary Wollstonecraft, A Vindication of the Rights of Women, in 1792. Virginia Woolf, A Room of One's Own, in 1929. And Simone de, The Second Sex, 1949. The movement starts in 1960 in America. Feminist canon. Those literary work that are about women either written by women or they might be written by men, but dealing with the issues related to women. What is feminism? It is the work that is written about women, their various problems, status in different walks of life, and their work field. And feminist literature is the literature written by women, even those works in which issues and problems are related to them are written, is called feminist literature. There were men who wrote about women that is considered as feminist literature. Example, Rabindranath Tagore, Bankim Chandra. They wrote about widows, especially child widows who suffer a lot because of the traditions existing in the society. There were male writers who tried to raise voice against these hardships borne by women, but in England and America, when there is clear-cut literature where women should be given some significance, but it was not until 20th century. In the mid of 20th century, that is in 1960, women of India also started writing about their fellow sisters. The history says that in literature, work of women was invisible, and we can say that literature of men was considered history of civilization. Feminism then came forward to make the women's position visible from the margin of the society to the present. It was an effort to throw light on the capabilities of women as writers. Now we can say that feminism bring the suppressed narratives to women's experiences into light. Now our last topic of this video is feminism in literature. In order to understand feminism, just go through the thinking of important and influential people. First one is Aristotle. He was the Greek philosopher and he wrote that the relation of male to female is by nature a relation of superior to inferior and of ruler to ruled. Thomas Jefferson said, who was the third US president also, women's position is in house, not in politics and public office. Charles Darwin, who was the great scientist, said that man is intellectually superior to woman. So these were the thought process and mindset of most influential people. So one can understand the mindset of common people for the women in the society. Up to 18th century, no voice was raised against female inequality and for her status in the society. First challenge was accepted by Mary Wollstonecraft, who was known as grand mom of modern feminist writer. She writes Vindication of the Rights of Women with structures on political and moral subjects in 1792. And in this novel, she talked about man and woman should be treated equally. There should be co-education. Women also possess reason, so they should have all the rights that men have. Jean Jacques Rousseau, Emily. Women's role should be restricted to good mother and good wife. A woman's education must be planned in relation to men. And Mary Wollstonecraft criticized him and said, I do not wish women to have power over men, but over themselves. Vindication of the Rights of Women is called Feminist Declaration of Independence. First wave of feminism, it is the term coined by Martha Lear in 1848 to 1920. Starts unofficially with Mary Wollstonecraft's book, which was published in 1792. Officially with Beneca Falls of Convention in 1848, it is the meeting in which female rights were discussed. Main demand was political rights, suffrage movement or right to vote. Right to vote granted to women in New Zealand in 1893, UK in 1988 and US in 1920. So first wave of feminism ended when right to vote was given to women in 1920. But this wave was restricted to UK and US only. Second wave of feminism was in 1950 to 1980, a term coined by Martha Lear. main demand that raised voiced against women's oppression. Simone de Beauvoir, The Second Sex, 1949, starting point of second wave feminism, text divided into two books, book one named Analysis of Myths, book two is One is Not Born But Rather Became a Woman, Thinking About Women by Mary Ellman in 1968, Sexual Politics by Kate Millett in 1969, The Female Inach in Germaine Geer in 1970. Virginia Woolf, A Room for One's Own in 1929. According to her, a woman must have money and a room of her own if she is to write fiction. In the first place, to have a room of her own was out of question unless her parents were exceptionally rich or very noble. It would have been impossible completely and entirely for any woman to have written the plays of Shakespeare in the age of Shakespeare. For this, he created fictional character who was Judith Shakespeare, Shakespeare's sister. She was equally adventurous and imaginative, but she was not sent to school and she was deprived of education and opportunities, killed herself, whereas Shakespeare lives on. Woolf examined the career of several female authors. He appreciated Afra Behn, who was the first female to earn her own money from writing. Next is Elaine Showalter, Feminist Criticism in Wilderness, 1981. He was American literary critic and feminist. Three phases of feminist towards a feminist poetics in 1979. The feminine phase, 1840 to 1880, the feminist phase, 1880 to 1920, and the female phase, 1920. The feminine phase, imitation of male society. Women in effort to equal the intellectual achievement of the culture, and it was the period of male pseudonym. Feminist phase, protesting of male society. Women's writing that protested against male standards, advocating against women's rights and values. And third was female phase, which was self-discovery. It rejects both imitation and protest, turned instead the female experience the source of autonomous art. Into what's a feminist poetics shows divides feminist criticism into feminist critique, the woman as reader, kinocritics, the woman as writer. Third wave of feminism. It was led by the Generation Zers, who was born in 1960s, 70s, emerged in mid-1912, credited to Rebecca Walker's daughter of Alice Walker, article in 1992, becoming the third wave. She was against Clarence Thomas, who was nominated for SC of US and had sexually harassed Anita Hill. She wrote, "I am not a post-feminism feminist, I am a third wave." Fourth wave of feminism began in 2012, whose focus was justice of women and opposition to sexual harassment and violence against women. So, with this, our video has come to an end. I believe that you have easily understood the topic. Link to the PDF notes is given below in the comment section. Please like, share and comment on the video, and do subscribe the channel for more video updates. Thank you and have a nice day.